I changed the title slightly to be a bit more appropriate for this session, to at least have the word constructed wetland in there. So it will now be the use of constructed wetlands within a regional water grid for industrial water provision. And as Huub already mentioned, this research was performed within the Water Nexus program by me during my PhD at the universities of Amsterdam and Wageningen. Well, what is the Water Nexus program? The Water Nexus program was a large program with the aim to lower the pressure on freshwater resources in delta areas worldwide. And the ambition of Water Nexus was to do that by using saltwater resources instead of freshwater resources, mitigating this pressure on freshwater resources. And these freshwater resources are under pressure because we have increasing population in delta areas, but also increasing industrial activities, but also some natural phenomena, climate change, salinization, saltwater coming more inwards to the delta areas. And with this use of saltwater instead of freshwater, and our slogan, salt water when possible, freshwater when needed, zout waar het kan, zoet waar het moet in Dutch, we were aiming to alleviate this pressure on freshwater resources. Is it connected? Yeah, there we go. And Water Nexus tried to do this by looking at three different main topics. And one of these topics was actually, where do we have fresh water? Where do we have salt water in the subsurface? And how can we sustainably extract the fresh water that is there without causing problems with salt water intrusion? And how does this react on future scenarios if we have a larger population in these delta areas, if we extract more water? Another part of Water Nexus dealt with the development of treatment technologies for salt water. Biological treatment technologies, such as granular sludge beds, but also technologies to desalinate salt water and use it for industrial processes. Think about technologies such as nanofiltration, but also advanced technologies such as electrochemical oxidation. And a third part of Water Nexus aimed at developing a regional water grid in which water that was useful for perhaps an industry or agriculture could be transported to the appropriate location. And where do we then get this water from? Is it perhaps more beneficial to take water from another source or to treat local available wastewater? And how can we all implement this in a grid for a whole region, not only taking into account industries, but also taking into account agriculture, nature, and perhaps also drinking water companies. And Water Nexus was not only done by the universities of Wageningen or the University of Amsterdam where I worked, but we worked in a very large consortium with users from various sectors. And this was very important for this Water Nexus program. So we worked together with industrial end users that use a lot of water, but also produce a lot of water. We worked together with technology developers that develop technologies for the treatment of this water, consultancy technology companies, but also the water authorities that are in charge of the water system, drinking water companies that, of course, also need water for their production of their drinking water, and the research institutes and universities. And within this regional concept of this water grid, we foresaw that constructed wetlands had a very important role, because these constructed wetlands could have multiple functions, not only for the treatment of wastewater, but also for storage of large volumes of water. And constructed wetlands are man-made wetland systems that are based on natural wetland systems. And in these systems, you have a lot of different removal mechanisms working together to remove pollutants from the water. So you have microorganisms in there that can biodegrade components. You have components that stick to the soil surface, adsorption. You have photodegradation of components, but also plants in there that take up components and stimulate also the microorganisms in there. And yeah, we foresaw that these could have an important role in these treatment schemes that we were developing for the treatment of saline water. And with our constructed wetland research, we focused on two specific cases for saltwater treatment. And one of the cases you see on the left, where we focused on the treatment of cooling tower water. Cooling tower is a mildly saline, brackish water stream that is produced a lot because industrial facilities use a lot of water for cooling. But this water is not too salt and also not too dirty, so this would be a suitable candidate to use instead of fresh water to alleviate this pressure on freshwater resources. And we also looked at the case study where we looked into the treatment of processed water from the oil and gas industry for the production of oil. Usually per barrel of oil, about 10 barrels of water are produced. And what happens now is that this water is discharged either in sea or in the subsurface. And especially in desert areas like the Middle East, this water could be used for other purposes, such as for greening the desert or also for the production of agricultural crops, usually non-food crops, such as cotton and sea salt. So we looked into these different case studies, and with this came some different research questions. So in this first or the second case study, where we were looking into the treatment of oil and gas process water, we mainly focused on what is the impact of the salinity of this water on the removal of pollutants that are in this water, and especially the pollutants that they are adding to the water to extract oil and gas, and also which plants are able to cope with this salinity and which not. So we simulated this desert environment in a climate chamber, and we had this constructed wetlands in there on a small scale with different plant types, and we gradually increased the salinity. And with this increasing salinity, we saw that the removal efficiency started to go down because the microorganisms could not adapt at a certain moment anymore. And also because of the high temperatures, there was a lot of evaporation, which was even increasing the salinity even more. But as you can see in the picture on the right, you also see differences in how well the plants are surviving. So we could also determine which plants are more suitable for the bit more saline water streams. Well, for the treatment of this cooling tower water, we worked on a bit a larger scale. At our facilities in Wageningen, we have some wetlands outdoors next to the lab that you can see here. They are about 12 square meters, 3x4. And we looked into how we can apply wetlands with different characteristics for the treatment of this cooling tower water. Because you can design a wetland or construct a wetland in such a way that you can either have a bit more aerobic conditions or a bit more anaerobic conditions, or you can boost the adsorption a bit, or you can use some certain plants, and you can also combine this. And we were wondering what would be the most optimal order of this aerobic and anaerobic wetlands for the treatment of cooling tower water. Well, most of you probably have plants in your house, so you are aware that it takes some time for the plants to grow and for the system to start developing. So it took some years for us to grow these wetlands. In the picture on the left, you can see the first growing season. And in the picture on the right, you can see the next year where the plants are fully grown. And you see that these are some trains of different types of wetland in which we had all these different removal mechanisms. And we run this experiment with cooling tower water that we made ourselves because it was impossible to transport the volumes that we needed from the cooling tower water. And our focus here was on the removal of some micropollutants that are present in this cooling tower water, and in which wetlands then they would be removed most optimally. We had nice climatic conditions on the left. Luckily, there were some students by then that could help me doing the experiments. I didn't have to go outside. But for instance, we saw during this period that the removal efficiency of these wetlands for these micropollutants, that was in generally quite good, dropped down a bit because of lower microbial activities, no plant activities. And we also had some unanticipated results. For instance, in the picture on the right, we saw that in these two different wetlands that are behind each other, that the wetland in the beginning was removing too much nutrients. So in the second wetland, there were no nutrients left anymore for the plants, and that's why the plants in that second wetland looked that yellow. And those were some things that we did not think of beforehand, but are very useful to know for when we are going to apply this on a larger scale. And I think Mireille will present something about that in the presentation later. Well, now that we've proved that these wetlands were actually working for this treatment of cooling tower water, we also wanted to take up these wetlands in a more bigger integrated treatment train, because these wetlands remove these micropollutants but are not able, for instance, to take out the salts from the water. So reuse of this water for purposes where there is fresh water needed was not possible yet. So we combined this with nanofiltration as a pretreatment to take out some of the components that might foul the nanofiltration membranes. And afterwards, we still had to perform also reverse osmosis and electrochemical oxidation for the treatment of the permeate of the nanofiltration and the concentrated stream that you also produce with membrane technologies. And we saw actually that this constructed wetland that we then built at the industrial premises in the south of the Netherlands was doing a good job in removing this industrial micropollutants. This is a picture of when it was just built in the summer of 2018. And here you see a picture of when it was fully functional. So there it was directly connected to this real cooling tower water. And we could also again see influences of the climate on these constructed wetlands again. So we saw that it was able to remove this micropollutants. However, there were also some production of compounds that were actually causing a bit of extra fouling of the nanofiltration membrane. So whether the constructed wetland is a suitable pretreatment or not is still a question mark. And I think in the background you see also a bit of the wetland that Mireille will talk about later. And that was of a bit larger scale than what we were doing. But yeah, this, in the end, this pretreatment train was well able to make suitable fresh water out of cooling tower water, brackish cooling tower water, for reuse in the cooling tower again or for other industrial purposes. And coming back to this regional concept of water nexus, we could then also use this knowledge in the decision whether it could be more suitable to transport water from a different location, fresh water from a different location, and use it in the industrial facilities, or perhaps use water from the location itself and treat it there. And more information about this can be found in the Water Nexus final report, which is online by now, which I can also send to you if you leave me your post address. And this knowledge that we obtained in Water Nexus will also be used for further research into these regional water grids. Just recently, we started a new large research program with, again, a lot of stakeholders from the water sector, the drinking water companies, the water boards, the industrial end users, but also now a strong focus on the social part of implementing this regional water grid. What are the legal boundaries for implementing these water grids? What is the perception of people when using treated wastewater for different applications? And this program is called Aqua Connect. If you want to have more information about this, please also reach out. And thereby, I'm open for questions.
Not sure whether, yeah. The mic is doing it. So are there any questions to Thomas Wagner for his presentation? Many? Okay, so I go start in the back and then I come up front, yeah? So.
Thank you so much for the presentation. Maybe one question, which micropollutants are we talking about? Pesticides or?
Well, we had a specific focus on micropollutants that they use in cooling towers to keep the system clean. So especially biocides and corrosion inhibitors, and then a focus on benzotriazole, also with a micropollutant that is present in a lot of surface water and in the STOA candidate micropollutant list.
Yes, sufficiently answered. Yeah.
Yeah. Hello, I just wanted to ask what type of constructed wetland you used. Do you use a hybrid system? Do you use the horizontal, vertical flow?
Yeah, a hybrid system of both a horizontal, a vertical, and the open water flow. So I can go back to the picture, perhaps. No, I cannot go back to the picture anymore. But it was a sequence of horizontal, vertical, and open water. Yeah, oh, this is a beautiful picture. So this is the vertical one, the open water, and the horizontal one.
Okay.
So where do the micropollutants go? Do they go into the plant or are they absorbed? And what, where do they in the end go?
Yeah, that was actually the main question of my whole research. So you see that with this benzotriazole, a large part of it is degraded by the microorganisms. But also part sticks to the soil. And in the beginning, you have mainly sticking to the soil. But when the microorganisms are getting more used to this benzotriazole, they are also developing in such a way that they become able to degrade them.
Yes. I never give away the mic.
All right. So, out of, I mean, ignorance, right? You showed this absolutely huge chimney of this using, I mean, this big factory for such a big thing. How big is the surface of plants you need to treat all that stuff?
Yeah, I mean, big. So I made a very rough calculation once. Based on the experiments that we did with the volumes that I was using. And if we would replicate the same time that the water would stay in the wetlands, it would be about 10 hectares. But then there are still some measures to be able to take and to lower that.
Okay. Oh, not another question.
Considering the biocides, they're of course made to disinfect. So you would expect that certain concentrations that really also limits the microorganisms. What can you say about that?
Yeah, we studied it. So we actually pumped in water with these biocides in the constructed wetlands, and we saw that it did not have a lot of effect. And we were using concentrations that were higher than what was actually coming out of the constructed wetland or the cooling tower. And we think the reason for that is twofold. One is that these biocides are very reactive and they have a very short half-life. That's also the reason why they can now just discharge this water on the surface water. And the other one is that it also, this reaction with the microorganisms and the soil happens very quickly in the upper layers of the constructed wetland where it adsorbs. And then you miss the reactivity. No. It was not that long term that we could see that. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Have you tried different types of plants to see if there's maybe like more degradation or I don't know with other plants so that you don't need so much space?
Not for this project that was outdoors. And the plants are not the main critical factor in to determine how much space you need. It's mainly the amount of time that you want the water to be in the system, or that you need the water to be in the system for complete degradation of certain components. And you can play also a bit with the depth of your wetland. So if it's a bit deeper, you need a bit less space. Yeah.
And the salinity resistance maybe can be play a role to for the choice of plants or
Salinity is an important factor for plants, but what we see that the normal reed that you find everywhere along the ditches that is well able to cope with the salinities of this cooling tower water.
Last question.
Thank you, Thomas. I would like to add to the question on the plants. So you showed a picture of the yellow plant. You said there was nutrient limited. Do you know which nutrient was limited?
We assume nitrogen limitation. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Thomas.